When I was a child, growing up, learning what it meant to follow Jesus, one of the first things I can remember discovering was that to be a follower of Jesus, it meant that you needed to give up this life in exchange for eternal life. I can remember as young as my kids, hearing preachers say that, learning that in Sunday school, that you give up this life knowing that heaven is what we're living for. One of the first things I learned. That's kind of what Jesus meant when he said, "What will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul?" What would it profit a man if everything that they wanted in this life they got, but in exchange, he lost his soul? That used to be the things that every Christian believed that when I was growing up. Well, little by little, that kind of teaching, that kind of thinking is quickly starting to dwindle away. And it's being replaced with something completely different. The new American smartphone supercharged, internet-dependent drive-through lifestyle has created a new kind of Christianity that's been emerging little by little into our culture. It's a culture that says, I can have both. I can gain God and the whole world. That's kind of the thing that the church has been embracing little by little, day by day. We've been conditioned to think this way. I want to play for you a quick snippet, 10-second snippet of a song that many of you, if you grew up in the 70s, you might remember hearing this on the radio a lot. 10 seconds or so. Listen to this snippet.
I want it all. I want it all. I want it all. And I want it now.
How many of you remember that song? Sure, I had a feeling. Big business knows exactly what they're doing when they advertise to viewers. They make no mistake. They spend millions and even billions of dollars to make sure that their idea is portrayed exactly the way that they believe consumers will digest it and then buy it. The product really isn't even as significant as the idea that they're selling. Now, I found about three commercials, recent commercials, which used that song as the idea for selling their product. And I put them together, I cut out little pieces of it to show you. These are big names. Coca-Cola, Dr. Pepper, which is owned by Snapple, and Verizon all chose that song as their theme song. Can you play that for us, Frank?
Your toys want more. They need more. So get more guaranteed from Verizon Fios.
I want it all. I want it all. I want it now. I want it all.
Want it all? Then you'll love the 23 flavors packed into the one bold taste of Dr. Pepper.
This is the spirit that America has bought into. And little by little, the church has started to embrace it as well. The fact that we can have God and also the whole world. We don't have to choose between one or the other like Jesus said. That kind of thinking is old. It's ancient. It's dinosaur kind of thinking. We can have everything that we want right at our fingertips. I want to pose to you six questions right as we get started here. I like to get questions that will help people's mind get thinking in the direction that our text will take us. So these are six questions that our culture has started to encourage people to think, whether consciously or subconsciously. And really, they're all the same question, six different ways. If we could put that up on the screen, if we get that going. Okay, I'll read it to you. First question. Why would I ever deny myself something that isn't wrong to have? Think about it. Why would I ever deny myself something that isn't wrong to have? Number two, why would I ever restrain myself of something I have freedom to enjoy? Number three, why would I ever choose to wait when I can have it now? Number four, Why would anyone intentionally choose the long route when there's a shorter route to go? Who would do that? Number five, why would anyone willingly delay gratification? Would anybody willingly do that on purpose? Why? Last one, why would anyone prolong enjoyment? Put it off. If I can have it, I should have it, and I will have it. That's the kind of thinking that the whole world is starting to embrace. If I can have it, I should have it. I'm entitled to it. This is the way that the world goes. And ever since the trick took place, back in the Garden of Eden, the trick with a capital T, Satan, the serpent, has been little by little, gradually getting this whole world. He's building a kingdom just like God is building a kingdom. And this is what he's trying to accomplish. Restraining yourself of something that you've earned is foolishness. Waiting for something is foolishness when you can have it now. This is the trick of the serpent, and he's been doing it since the very beginning. Even Snickers has their tagline, "Hungry? Why wait?" Well, like we try to teach our kids, you wait because you'll spoil your dinner. Right? Didn't your mom or dad tell you that when you were growing up? But Snickers now wants you to realize, don't wait, just eat it. Okay, today we're going through the second half of the book of Genesis. We started it last week, and here's what's happening in case you weren't here. Isaac and Rebekah are about to have babies. Twin boys. Twin boys. And Rebekah went to seek the Lord because something was going on in there that was not normal. And she heard from God, and God told her, yeah, there are two nations inside your womb, and the older will serve the younger, which is completely opposite to what usually happens in Hebrew culture. So they're about to give birth. Jacob and Esau's story is about to begin, and it is a complex story to say the least. But their story, right at the beginning, brings to the forefront something that every Christian needs to be absolutely aware of in this day and age. That there is a great trickster who seeks to undermine what God wants to do in your life. And this is really the point of what we're going to see in today's passage. The title for this morning's message is Trickster Tactics. Try to say that 10 times real fast. Trickster tactics. My aim today will be to uncover some of Satan's most common tactics in getting God's people to give up or exchange what God has prepared for them for something cheap and worthless. Before we go to the text, let's pray together. God, who knows? Maybe the enemy is at work here today trying to distract us from the truth that's found in your word. But we will not be distracted. We will not be thrown off course, because greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And we believe, God, that your word is truth, and that it has something very valuable for us. And so I pray that you would speak to everyone who's here today, speak to their minds, speak to their souls, speak to their heart, because we need you. We are a needy people, oh God. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Turn with me in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 25. We're going to be reading 10 verses today. Five of those verses will be just for context, and then the other five will be our main focal point. Genesis 25, beginning in verse 24 and continuing through 34. If you don't have your Bibles, it'll be displayed up on the screen. It says this: when her days to give birth were completed, behold, there were twins in her womb. The first came out red, all his body like a hairy cloak. So they called his name Esau. Afterward, his brother came out with his hand holding Esau's heel. So his name was called Jacob. Isaac was 60 years old when she bore them. When the boys grew up, Esau was a skillful hunter, a man of the field, while Jacob was a quiet man dwelling in tents. Isaac loved Esau because he ate of his game, but Rebekah loved Jacob. Once when Jacob was cooking stew, Esau came in from the field, and he was exhausted. And Esau said to Jacob, "Let me eat some of that red stew, for I'm exhausted." Therefore his name was called Edom. Jacob said, "Sell me your birthright now." Esau said, "I'm about to die. Of what use is a birthright to me?" Jacob said, "Swear to me now." So he swore to him and sold his birthright to Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and lentil stew, and he ate and drank and rose and went his way. Thus Esau despised his birthright. The big idea that I believe God has for us to learn in this text for today is about robbery. I put it down for you like this. The trickster aims to rob you of your birthright. Now, I chose my words very, very carefully here, so if it's not real clear to you, give me some time to unpack this for you, and it will become clear. The trickster aims to rob you of your birthright. The passage is all about something called a birthright, so we should probably understand what that is, right, before we go any further. I think some people have kind of a distorted understanding of what a birthright is. So birthright is a distinctly Jewish thing, which has eventually become something that other cultures have practiced. But the word denotes the privileges and advantages belonging to the firstborn son among the Jews. Now, when we think of a birthright, we typically think of like a will, where people get financial things given to them, or material things, or land deeded over to them. That's only a secondary part of what a birthright is really all about. The first thing, and the most important thing, is that whoever got the birthright became the priest of the family. This was like an incredible honor. If you were handed over the birthright, that meant that all the responsibility and duties of training up that your family that would follow in the ways of God came to you. This was a tremendous privilege and carried around a lot of respect and dignity and honor. Here are the values of a birthright in order of their importance. Number one, all the functions and responsibilities of the priesthood. That was the key thing. Number two, a double portion of the material inheritance, including the land. So there was like a will type of a thing to this. The third thing, rulership and authority. If you were a Jewish king like David or Solomon, it was assumed that the birthright, the authority of the kingship, would be handed over to your firstborn son. Now, you might be reading through the Bible and find, in certain cases, this isn't the way it goes. These are not hard, fast rules that Hebrew people would hold on to. These were more general principles. There are many cases where a Jewish father, would pass along the birthright to a second son or a third son rather than the firstborn son. Or there's even a couple cases where God does it. So again, this is not a rule. This is just a general practice. In this passage, along with many others that are going to follow, the differences between Esau and Jacob they're brought to the forefront. This is something we want to focus on before we even get into the story about how he sold his birthright. So we're going to focus on these differences for just a minute. And don't tune out. You've got to catch this, okay? First, we're going to focus on the physical differences. When they first came out of their mother's womb, there were already differences noted. Their names. Let's start with their names. First, Esau. Esau means hairy. Interesting thing to name your child, right? But Jewish people, Hebrew people, did something very different. Their names weren't just random names that they chose that they liked. They meant something. Esau named hairy. Next, verse 30 says this. And this is important. Esau said to Jacob, "Let me eat some of that red stew, for I'm exhausted." Therefore, his name was called Edom. Eventually, remember how God told Rebecca that there were two nations in her womb? Eventually, all the people that would come from this one man would be called the Edomites. Do you know what Edom means? Red. That's what it meant. This became such a stigma that followed this man around that throughout all of history of these people that still exist on the planet today, the Edomites were called red. That's how significant what we're about to read eventually became. This is huge. Now, the next thing, go ahead and put the next one up. The people derived from Esau were named Red, okay? Put Jacob's up there for me. Jacob's name was something far more important. This is crucial for our understanding of the text. In verse 26, it said, "Afterward, his brother came out with his hand holding Esau's heel. So, or therefore, or because that happened, his name was called Jacob." Jacob's name means something that is so important. The root word, the word Jacob, means heel. Heel. Drawn out a little bit further, it literally means grabber of the heel or holder of the heel. This is not a flattering thing to be named. In fact, the phrase still exists today. Have you ever heard someone call another person, "Oh, you're such a heel"? You ever heard that? You know what that means? Someone will use that in a context when somebody is being like a con artist or a deceiver or a trickster. If we look at what Esau later says, two chapters later, about his brother, look at what he says in Genesis 27:36. Put the next one up. Esau said, "Is he not rightly named Jacob?" So he's referring to his name here. "For he has cheated me or tricked me these two times. He took away my birthright, and behold, now he's taken away my blessing." So this man's name, Jacob, eventually came to be known as Trickster, con artist, deceiver. Boy, anybody know someone named Jacob? Let them know that this is what their name originally meant. I'm sure they'll really appreciate that. This is what it meant in the original Hebrew. Jacob and Esau had all the ingredients in their household for dissension to occur. Everything that was needed for these two men to just do this all their life was present. Even how their parents felt about them. Did you catch what it said there? Isaac loved Esau, but Rebekah loved Jacob. Now, don't get all caught up on that. Here's what that means. The word loved there is not what you and I think it means. It means showed preference to. Isaac showed preference to Esau, and Rebekah showed preference to Isaac. Some would even say that Isaac was an outdoorsman, loved hunting in the field, loved being outdoors just like his dad did. And so, sure, you could understand how they'd be buddy-buddy. Some have even gone as far to say that Jacob was a homemaker, loved being at home with his mom, just loved the quiet life with his mom, taking care of the family, making the household dinners. You can see how there'd be some jealousy, bitterness, anguish all through their lives, right? Everything that was needed for dissension to be present was there. I like how Matthew Henry put this idea about one loving the other. He said, one was the father's darling and the other the mother's darling. The Bible goes to great lengths to talk about the differences between these two boys, but the primary difference is what they desired. Their desire was the major thing that separated these two boys. Jacob chased after something that didn't belong to him his entire life. Think of it like a football player, okay? Take a look up here. Imagine this. A football player is running to the end zone right over there, and there's somebody chasing after him, and he knows if he can just strip that ball away, then the guy won't score the touchdown. So he's chasing after him, and he's a little bit faster, so he dives to go and grabs it, to go and grab him, and all he can reach out and grab for is the other player's heel. And that's it. That's kind of the picture that was painted of Jacob, always striving for something that was just barely out of his reach. He wanted desperately what was given over to his brother Esau as a birthright. This was something that was characteristic of his entire upbringing and eventually his entire life. Jacob desired the noble thing, though. He desired, even though his means to get it was despicable. Man, I can tell you, as I was preparing for this entire week, I lost track of the number of times that my desire to do something, my motives to do something were good, but the means that I employed to do it were just wrong. I did that a lot in my young life. That's Jacob. Jacob desired to have the priestly oversight of the family. And you know what Paul said about that? Take a look at what Paul said. 1 Timothy 3:1, he says, whoever aspires to be an overseer desires a noble task. So what Jacob was desiring, to have this priestly honor, was a good thing. It's a good thing. But his means to do it, despicable. His brother Esau, his life would be characterized by that one phrase at the end there, he despised his birthright. The New Testament talks about Esau too. Look at what it says. Hebrews 12:16 says he was a godless man. Look at what it says. See to it that no one is an immoral or godless person like Esau, who sold his own birthright for a single meal. Esau's craving for immediate gratification became his undoing. And you'll see, a couple chapters later, he's completely undone by this. Regrets what he did. Completely ruined by it. But his, over time, this desire to have his immediate needs met became just commonplace for him. This was no sudden impulse on the part of Esau, just like it was no brilliant idea on the part of Jacob. These are things that have been growing in them over the years. This was something that had been plotted by Jacob, and he was waiting for the exact moment to carry it out on Esau, to strip him of what he owned. Jacob the heel, Jacob the trickster, played the serpent in this role in their lives. He played the role that Satan played in the Garden of Eden. He had devoted all of his energy to conning his brother out of his rights and privileges. This is precisely what the trickster aims to do with every single Christian that has ever walked the face of the earth. The trickster aims to rob you of your birthright. There are divine privileges. I don't know if you know this. There are divine privileges that are offered, that are told, that will be given to every single Christian when we finally end this life. Divine privileges. The end objective of Satan is to make the church into a gathering of Esau's who are willing to trade what God has promised to us in Christ for the various bowls of soup that Satan will put in our path. Things that fade as quickly as the latest iPhone. Allow me to point out for you two tactics that Satan will use to trick you out of what is yours. Tactic number one, the trickster aims at your vulnerabilities. Esau had been conditioned by the trickster to obey his cravings. Look back with me at verses 29 through 31. It says this. Once when Jacob was cooking stew, Esau came in from the field, and he was exhausted. And Esau said to Jacob, "Let me eat some of that red stew, for I'm exhausted." Therefore his name was called Edom. Jacob said, "Sell me your birthright now." Satan strikes at your weakest points. The times in your life where you are most tired, most exhausted, most worn down, just like Esau was here. That is the place, those are the times when Satan will attack you most. He aims for your vulnerabilities. And every person has these. Everyone. If you're sitting here this morning and you're thinking, listen, I've been alive for a long time. I do a pretty good job of controlling myself. I just don't have those kind of vulnerabilities anymore, those weak spots. You're lying to yourself. Everyone does. Some people have a desire for food. Some people it's money or power. Some people it's sex. Some people it's notoriety. For some people, it's just ease of life. And it ends up becoming the thing, the driving force that propels them through their day. Friends, the enemy is going to devote all of his resources to striking at these vulnerabilities over your life. And if you don't protect your weak spots, you don't stand a chance against this enemy. None of us do. Listen to what the Apostle Paul says in Philippians 3. It's going to help us to understand what's at stake here should we decide to trade our eternal rights for momentary earthly pleasures. Look at what he says. We're going to divide this into two parts, 17 through 19 and then 20 through 21. Look at what he says. Brothers, join in imitating me and keep your eyes on those who walk according to the example you have in us. For many, of whom I have often told you and now tell you even with tears, walk as enemies of the cross of Christ. Now listen, their end is destruction. Their God is their belly, and they glory in their shame with minds set on earthly things. This is a good description of Esau. His God was his belly. When his belly said, jump, he said, how high? When his cravings kicked into gear, he obeyed them. When his flesh desired something, he had conditioned himself to obeying those cravings. This is a good description of Esau. The next two verses give us a description of a Jacob-type person. But, it starts out, verse 20 and 21, but, or as a way of comparison, our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body by the power that enables him to subject all things to himself. So, I don't know if you picked up on it here, but Paul is trying to make a comparison between an Esau type and a Jacob type. And the Esau type is someone who's controlled by their belly, always following the cravings of the flesh. The Jacob type, in verse 20 and 21, is ruled by something different. They're awaiting a Savior in heaven. Their mind is fixed on heaven. You see the difference between the two there? Now, the Bible is full of references to this inheritance that we'll get in heaven. Listen to a couple of verses that describe it. Ephesians 1:11, it says, in Christ we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will. Again, in Colossians 3:24, it says this, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. You are serving the Lord Christ. In a word, our inheritance is heaven. That's what it is. It's everything that is contained within our salvation. And the enemy aims to take Christians who know that this is our inheritance and trick us into trading it for something that's worthless, valueless, like Esau did here. A bowl of soup simply because he was hungry. He traded something of infinite value. When Jacob said, sell me your birthright now. Again, this wasn't some instant brilliant idea. No, this trickster knew, and he was waiting for the exact moment to get what Esau had. because he knew that his weak spot was his belly. Esau had been conditioned to esteem impulsivity. And when the moment was right, the trickster made his move. So let me make this personal to you. What vulnerabilities do you think the enemy, this trickster, this deceiver, will strike at you? As I said, everyone has some. I'm going to give you three fill-in-the-blank questions. I'm going to put them up on the screen. I want you to pay close attention to this. You can jot them down if you want to. Maybe you want to answer these when you get home. Don't share these with anybody. Just keep it to yourself. Answer these questions. When I'm tired, irritated, frustrated, or overwhelmed, I often crave blank. Remember, Esau was tired and exhausted when this enemy, this trickster, attacked him. Number two, when I see a TV commercial or show that contains blank, it's hard for me not to want it. Number three, and perhaps the most important one, if there were no consequences, I would blank. No consequences. You won't get caught. You won't gain weight. Nobody will find out. Nothing will happen to you. I would do this. Friends, your answers to those questions might just reveal to you the battleground upon which your soul is being fought for. And it will give you the tools you need to fight. But you have to be honest. You have to be honest before the Lord. You have to be honest with yourself. You know where your weak spots are and where this trickster who desires to rob you of what is rightfully yours in Christ, you know where he's going to aim. This is your soul we're talking about. Esau traded it like it was nothing. Which brings us to the second tactic that Satan aims to employ in robbing you of your birthright. Tactic number two, the trickster aims at your values. Esau had been conditioned to see his birthrights and privileges as being worthless. Look back at the text, 32 through 34. Esau said, I'm about to die. Of what use is a birthright to me? Jacob said, swear to me now. So he swore to him and sold his birthright to Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and lentil stew, and he ate and drank and rose and went his way. Thus Esau despised his birthright. The only reason anyone would sell anything, usually, is because they believe that what they're getting in return is of greater value than what they're selling. Usually that's the case, right? Esau says here, in essence, what use is the birthright to me? Food is what sustains me. All he cared about was the moment-by-moment pleasures. Let me tell you a story of how I kind of learned this when I was younger. Kids, I think you'll appreciate this. When I was in between fifth and sixth grade, I was in the chorus and the band. And I used to play trumpet. And trumpets were expensive. My mother paid several hundred dollars to buy me this trumpet from my school. And so the time for the Christmas play, the Christmas cantata came up. My mom showed up at school, and she came and she listened to me, and I had a solo in the chorus that year. And so I was singing, and then the band went and played. And afterwards, my mother came up to me, and she said, you did great! I love the chorus. I love your solo. It was fantastic. But I didn't see you in the band. Where were you? And in that moment, I'd realized that I was in big trouble. Because I'd forgotten to tell my mom about something that I'd done a year prior. I'd put it out of my mind and realized in that moment I started sweating. Here's what I did. One day, I'd forgotten my lunch money. And so I'm in the cafeteria watching everybody eat. And I was hungry. And so I sold my trumpet for $5 for two pieces of pizza and never told my mom. So between fifth and sixth grade, she thought I was at band practice while I was just hanging out at the school. And so she showed up to hear me sing in the Christmas cantata, and I was nowhere to be found because I'd sold something of tremendous value by way of comparison for an immediate impulse, a craving. And I regret it. I regret it to this day that I didn't stick with that. And as I said, Esau, two chapters later, will severely regret the decision that he made. Severely regret it. So, how do we learn to dominate our cravings? This is the big culmination here, so don't tune out. How do we do this? How do we learn to dominate the cravings of our flesh? Because we all have them. How do we master the flesh instead of the flesh mastering us? Isn't that what everybody wants to know? Some of you may be familiar with a very well-known professor from Columbia University named Walter Michel. Dr. Walter Michel was made famous by these tests that he conducted with children. They're famously known now simply as the marshmallow test. Has anybody heard of this before? Okay, some of you are nodding your head. There's a famous book written about this. It's been improved on and used many different times. I want you to hear, in his own words, what Dr. Michel said about why he started studying how self-control influences a person's life, why people would trade immediate gratification for delayed gratification, and then I've spliced together a little modern test of what it looks like with these children. I thought you'd enjoy seeing it. Frank, would you cue that up, and hopefully it won't shut out on us.
My name is Walter Michel, and I'm a professor at Columbia University. What I have been studying for about 45 or 50 years now is how children develop self-control and what the implications of self-control are for their lives as they grow up. Self-control, which used to be called willpower, is obviously terribly important. It's been an issue for us ever since Adam and Eve lost paradise because they couldn't resist the temptation of the serpent and the apple. What I developed when I started studying the problem of self-control is a measure that's now called the marshmallow test.
Okay, sit in that chair. All right, here's the deal. Marshmallow for you. You can either wait, and I'll give you another one if you wait, or you can eat it now. When I come back, I'll give you another one. So then you'll have two. But stay in here and stay in the chair till I come back, okay?
Okay.
All right. So it's up to you. You can have it now or you can wait. Okay? How'd you do? Did you do good? You did?
Yeah.
You wanted to eat it, didn't you? Yeah. So did I tell you I'd give you another one? Okay, now you can have both. You need them.
Cute, right? Now, what they did not show, I cut that down as much as I could. What they did not show in that video was all the follow-up tests that happened. And this is what's going to be really important to you. The follow-up test that Dr. Michel did was he brought in a second group of children. And he told those children, he gave them a little strategy to try to make this work for them. He said, when you go in, I want you to imagine in your mind that these marshmallows are not really marshmallows, that they're clouds. Think of the fluffiness, think of how they float over the sky. And then he brought in a third group of children, different group, and he told them, I want you to imagine the saltiness and crunchiness of pretzels. Now, the results were astounding. The group that imagined the cloud-like nature of the marshmallows, they did a little bit better than that group who wasn't told anything, that just had to use willpower to keep themselves from eating the one marshmallow. They did okay. But the astounding differences of the group that focused on pretzels was almost off the charts. What Michelle learned was this. Frank, can you put that back up on the screen for me? He learned that one of the most effective ways to distract ourselves from a tempting pleasure we don't want to indulge is by setting our minds on a greater future pleasure. You know why this is so interesting? This professor from Columbia University says almost word for word exactly what the Bible says is the trick for how you can sustain yourself in times of temptation. Almost exactly. Listen to what it says. I chose just a few verses. Colossians 3:2. Set your minds on the things that are above, not on the things that are on the earth. Galatians 5:16, perhaps the most important one. So I say, walk by the Spirit. That's another way of saying set your mind on God. Walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. Walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. Romans 8:5-8. Listen carefully. For those who live according to the flesh, that's a way of saying those who obey their various cravings. Those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. For those who are in the flesh cannot please God. Church, do you see what happened to Esau? He'd become so conditioned, he allowed his mind to become so set on seeing these passing cravings as so far more valuable than the pleasures that could be obtained by God, that he saw his birthright as being completely worthless. Jacob knew. Jacob knew exactly how valuable this birthright was. And so he desired the more noble thing. Every single person is in danger of the very same fate as Esau when we willingly trade the riches that can be had in a closeness to God for the various cravings of our flesh. This is the danger of every single believer, exchanging. The big idea again for today's message, as we come in for a close, the trickster aims to rob you of your birthright. He aims with a pinpoint accuracy at your vulnerabilities, your weak points, and your values, hoping that you'll one day exchange the glory of the Creator for the created things, worthless things, as it says in Romans 1:23. My exhortation to you is this. Make war. Fight. If you don't, this enemy will destroy you. You don't have any other choice. If you don't create a lifestyle of warfare against the enemy, you will be defeated. I want to invite you to stand. I want to read something to you. It comes from Ephesians 3. Everybody, please stand. It comes from Ephesians chapter 6. This is what it says. It says, finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand, therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for the saints. Dear God, I pray for every person in this room. I pray just as this passage in Ephesians 6 tells us, to be alert. Not to think like the world is thinking or like some of the church is thinking that, that devil can't get to me. He's just as real as God is. His hatred for us is just as real as God's love for us is. Help us to not fall into the trap of being an impulsive people, but to make sure by making war that we are storing up for ourselves treasures in heaven. And I ask this with assurance that Jesus Christ will work on our behalf. It's in His name that I pray.